get the mic for it. Get the mic for it.
Thank you. So like.
So that's what I'm trying. You just want to kill your own little money. So at this point, I'm going to call Dr. Philip Cornell, Councilman Gray, and Councilman White. Please.
Within the costume, there are identifiable neighborhoods.
So thank you for being here this evening, because out of these remarks that I made, Reverend Martin thought it was important that we come together to decide, to try to develop some consensus as to what do we call the African conferences of all the most important
conversation. proud of the fact that we had a question about the East End connotation. And I've understood and said I was going to drop it on the turn. And really, with the start of the conversation, it wasn't necessarily that it was like a change to the East End or anything else. But the East End is not a neighborhood. We have lots of neighborhoods. We go to Ward 7. Probably have 27 to 28 separate distinct neighborhoods that are well defined for people to look forward to being able to refer to. And we have areas across the city. I had somebody that came to my office recently that wanted to have a conversation about what was it like to grow up in Nome. I didn't grow up in Nome. I know we're going to get a lot of there. Nobody called me out there to go in and go. I said, I put the neighborhood up there. And the conversation was around this person who then identified areas of like 60 nails looking where I grew up, Wharton, other streets like that, as now referred to as Nome. And that's because the person who was conducting the interview felt that there was certain negative connotations that had to be addressed and to dealt with. The reality is that we have 150,000 people live or accept what they collectively. I guess the question for us is how would we address the same field of needs to address the negative connotation that is associated with where people live in Ward 7 and Ward 8. So I actually, the East End connotation or terminology is one that I was there. I put that on the table just to start a conversation. And boy, it is starting a conversation. There's no question about that. But you know what? It starts a conversation about how we make life better for people who live in Ward 7, Ward 8, in the District of Columbia, then it will serve its purpose. There are lots of different neighborhoods, that have changed. You know, Truxton, right? You know, Truxton, somewhere in the District of Columbia, Truxton. We got Brentwood, Brightwood, which would be Brighton. There's a lot of different names in the District of Columbia, neighborhoods. But at the end of the day, what it means to be able to live in a certain place in the District of Columbia. And those are the challenges that we have in place. How are we going to make sure that people have a chance to be able to live in the District of Columbia if they want to live, continue to live in the District of Columbia? How are we going to change education outcomes for our children in the District of Columbia? How are we going to change healthcare? How are we going to make the kind of environment, create the kind of environment that people feel like they are contributing to and have a role to shape? And if we have that kind of conversation tonight, we continue to work towards those kinds of outcomes that we see, it will have been time well spent. I think we need to say we want to change our name to West whatever. I think we'll accomplish absolutely nothing. The real purpose, I think, of this is how do we improve life and continue to do so. My understanding right now is that we're going to have several of these kinds of conversations going forward. I hope that that's the case, because one session is not going to accomplish anything. Five sessions are not going to accomplish anything unless we really focus the energy that we invest on what our outcomes are, what our desires are. I'm glad to see Bernard Gray here tonight. He's a man who I've known for so long in my life. He's been a resident of the county. Again, I'm proud to be a native Washington. Proud to have been able to contribute, but I've been never able to contribute to being able to improve life for people in the District of Columbia. For example, I'm very proud of being able to establish and continue early childhood education. There's no city in America, there's no state in America that has early childhood education. Every 3 or 4 year old in where they live. We are the only ones that do that. And that's what we need to build on the positive things that we are doing and make sure we continue to imbue that in the life of people in the District of Columbia. So I thank y'all for coming out.
Seems as though they both have the same general idea, regardless of the calling, what the conditions would be better improved in the board slightly would be. As Councilman Gray said, from Georgia early on, we're going to be Ward 15, we're going to go for. So that would be a good suggestion. So any comments or questions? What everybody say?
Sure. somebody who I think had an insecurity about where we live, right from there, right from home, right? And thought that we would be better as a result of moving uptown somewhere. I said, no, I'm not moving uptown. We need to change. And I wish I could say that every day is a positive one for me. And it happens. I don't care what you do. Not every day is a positive one for anybody. But no.
I believe that everything in life is deep.
father to take his clean and drugs and alcohol today.
Thank you. So I guess one of the things we started since I've been in office, this is a piece we call Resources to the Block. I don't know if you all heard of it. So basically what we've done, we've partnered with a lot of the government agencies, more specifically DBH. I know Travis from DBH has probably been on the front line with us. Also, we focus a lot of attention in the Malcolm X, MLK corridor, and also on the list of some community members like Robert McCain, who we came in front of this park right here. I don't know if you've seen this right there. We're just trying to figure out what some of the needs and services are for residents. So we try to empower people, because sometimes a lot of people look on government, which we do that role, but I learned that empower lives of people. So we try to figure out who in the community has a concern, a gift, or a talent to cater to that community. We try to work with them. So we've been in the community addressing that need. And also know that Councilmember Gray had a part of the bill yesterday spoke to the need to address the opioid crisis in the community. And I think that was for $1.3 million. So there are some lines in the budget that addresses that specifically, and which he can speak to. But we do partner with a lot of the government agencies, also the nonprofits in the community, to do outreach. It's called Resources to the Block. We want to do, in addition to that, this Friday at 6:30 p.m., Malcolm X is going to be okay at Avenue. They want to come out with us this Friday. And it's also going to address the issue of violence in our community as well. Thank you.
Side of the river. So keep your eyes open for me.
years ago. Prior to that, I lived in Arlington for about 16 years. And people do not talk with pride about living in Arlington the way people talk with pride about living in historic Holocaust era. That's one thing that really drew me to the neighborhood. That's one thing I really love. And I work in communications. I do feel that names are important. And I heard very clearly that one of the reasons why we are exploring the name is the connotation that people may have with Southeast or Ward 8. But my question is, my question is, who are we worried about that connotation? Because the neighbors love the neighborhoods that they live in. I don't see that there's a negative connotation with my neighbors about the neighborhoods that we live in. We're very proud to call our neighborhoods. So my question is, who are we trying to change that connotation for? And my sense is the developers.
To the river, but also show pride for residents. first person who spoke, so that regardless of what we name this side of the city, our history is better elevated, and it also can engage younger people who might not feel as much pride in their neighborhoods, whether they've been there a long time or for a short period of time.
Thank you for that question. I guess I think we could be doing more. One of the things I heard was about the signage. I know even in Stoke Anacostia, we have those signs along talking about the history of Anacostia, but the neighborhoods, you might not find as much. And I think that's a problem. I know one of the things we've been doing, I know Phil and Dale have taken a lead on this, starting with civic associations in the community to get the word out of people living in the first little Bellevue. Was one of the communities recently, and he has been trying to help people organize. And I don't really know really what people have been doing as a city to get the word out. I know some of the times in other parts of the city, we ride in the street, we see those signs up in the pole that show you our neighborhood, this whole branding, things that happen. And I know that with some of the corridors, complex and Anacostia, there's been some signage, but not massive signage about the neighborhood. I know that conversation also got the soul of the city with the new signage for trash cans and have some signs for the grandma. We said those are conversations, but there's really been individual efforts by leaders of civic associations, agencies that's been getting support through the main streets in DC, but pretty much been supported by the government, pretty much individual efforts. That's
Good evening. My name is Mysiki Valentine. I'm from the River Terrace community of Boston.
I do, however, think that there are legislative things that the both of you can do to ensure that there is growth within both of those communities. I think when people start seeing the east of the river growing, developing, and changing in the way that the people who live there want it to be, then the connotations will go away when it's on. When the crime rate goes down, then the connotations will go away when it's on.
Okay.
And I think when we start holding people accountable for the things that they don't do and the things that they do do, and the media as well, when we allow the media to brand us as just Southeast, that is a problem. And I think it takes leaders like you to stand up and say, no, we're not having this. No, we're not giving tax abatements to developers in some of the world because we're focused on our world. We want the progression of this to change. So I'm not in favor of the name change in any type of way, other than River Terrace. River Terrace is east of the river, and I'm perfectly fine with that. I've never felt any type of way about where I live, in what setting, crime or no crime. But I honestly believe that it's going to take serious work when that day is. Your vote is the power. These people have power. That's very true. But when you stand on that day is, and you go in the opposite direction of the progression of Ward 7 and Ward 8, then the negative commentary.
I will take a little liberty here because I just heard something that makes me want to say, you know, and Let's Talk with CJ. That's what made this possible, along with Greg Amati, who I think is the executive director for Let's Talk with CJ.
Because developers wanted to do what they wanted.
had very long, which was a black neighborhood. The Lanacostia, that heart of Lanacostia, which is the Uniontown description, which was named by the Congress back in 1902, I believe, is being wasted. And all of our communities are being wasted. And they're not serving our purpose, because when we move into a community, we do it for a reason. Whether we like the house, the layout, or whatever. But that's being wiped out by developers. And every time the council allows them to violate the historic district through laws that are on the books, and what they say, special agent of the District of Columbia can allow development for economic reasons. They wipe it out after this happens. So if you really want to do something to save your community, let's talk about keeping the names of that community, learning the history of those communities, and fighting.
They came up, I'm not sure they opened it back up again, but there was part of the female's movement
for public comments to hear commentary on what they want to see happen in the comprehensive plan. And it's hard because we have thousands and thousands of opinions, but I do know that we want to make sure there's strong language in it to speak to the community needs and also allow people to have pushback on this, just what the developers want versus what the community wants. And there's been a lot of conversations with him on that day in the community about text amendments and map amendments. And so now there's been some precedent set in the community from developers to try to change height restrictions on buildings because the judicial process through the PUD process, which the community input on, one of the loopholes they found is through text amendment and map amendment, where they can go back and change it for the office of zoning without getting community input. And so we had about six of those deployed in the last 3 months, in which we've been speaking against. But that's been a new conversation with the community about text amendments and map amendments to go ahead and broader conversation about it when it comes to the comments and plans. Thank you for that.
Thank you very much for the question. Thank you very much for the question. I heartily agree with you because maybe the most powerful tool that we have in the District of Columbia is the comprehensive plan. We had a hearing earlier this year that I think 280 witnesses that came down to the Wilson Building, and the hearing went on until about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, and people had to be absolutely exhausted by the time we got to the end of that hearing. I was there for the better part of the hearing. It's not a test of endurance, though. It's a test of engaging people in a way that respects the democratic process. And there's nothing about what I've seen thus far with this comprehensive plan this time around that respects the democratic process. By this time next year, we probably have a new comprehensive plan in the District of Columbia that is going to set the tone for the city for the next 25 to 30 years. And I really think that there's a great opportunity for Ward 7, Ward 8, working together with 150,000 people to try to make sure we bring whatever areas are going to be out, to bring the opportunity for people to get fully educated about it, to bring as much as we can to the community. It may be one of the most important things that we will do next 5, 7, 3 years, whatever the number may be, in order to influence what the shape of the communities where 7 and 8 would look like. So I would like to work with the council, like, to see what we can do to try to put the people together with Ward 8, with the people of Ward 7, to try to talk about what we want that to look like, and try to make sure that we do the kind of presentation, the kind of engagement, the kind of conversation that is necessary to ensure that we have a fair chance to understand what potentially could occur from this and what some of the implications are of what the plans are that are on the table.
Thank you. A couple of things. Council members, many of them spoke of their neighborhoods and over this side of the Lancaster River, southeast, northeast, southwest, and this side of the river, there are no signs. Is there any way, not this budget, the next budget, is there any way to put money, more money to the app, so we can get some signs, maybe 4 or 5 to each neighborhood? He said, sure. Is it one that we want? Absolutely, he said. So, well, I've not heard that. 2 people heard it. Okay. Councilman Gray said he would support the next budget period to put more money in DNAP with the signage for the neighborhoods over here on this side of the river. Councilman White said absolutely he would support that. That way, we need the maybe the ABCs and yes, they support that. Also,
big is not whether we vote on designation of East End or designation of East of the River, but what is it really going to do to try to effectuate the dynamics that we know can make a difference in the neighborhood? What is it that needs to be done? I would love time to be able to vote on a resolution for the council, and I'd be happy to join with Councilmember White on this. It says, here's what we think needs to happen with the comprehensive plan, or 7 or 8. Here's the implications of it, and here's what needs to be done from our perspective. That, I think, would give us something to debate, because I think if we get stuck on the East End, we're going to go nowhere. If we get stuck on the East End, we're going to go nowhere. And just conjure up a lot of negativity, I think, that really is not productive at all. I'd like to spend my time on figuring out how we're going to really shape the policy of the future that will make a difference in what our neighborhood look like every day. And doing that at the neighborhood level is absolutely very, very difficult.
That we didn't have a role to select, and who the partner is,
but there is a department that has been selected that is a reputable hospital organization. And we're working there to try to make sure that we not only have just a hospital, but we have a real healthcare system. What is shocking is there is no urgent care center now in Ward 8 or Ward 7. That's absolutely ridiculous. That people who have, you know, maybe some minor illnesses have to go to the emergency room in order to be served. So if you're asking me the question of, my support is, my support is totally there. The UMC is not going to close. It's not going to close before the hospital is ready. That's not going to happen. So I want to make that perfectly clear. I've heard various certain things that I've been saying. It's not going to happen.
Some next steps.
in Professor Carol Gibbs, who's a historian. And he's going to give us a lecture, a presentation from a historical perspective about the river, and the connecting neighborhoods to the river. We're going to bring Dr. Derek Musgrove out of Baltimore, University of Medical Maryland, Baltimore. He wrote the book, Chop the City. He's going to come and be one of our lecturers. There's a book that just came out, the History of England. Have you seen it? We're going to try to get her in to talk about, who is the sister that's talking about the history issue? Where did she go? She talks about the history here, right here. You were right on, because the history will help us to guide us to where we have to go in terms of whether we do it East End or East of the River. I prefer East of the River personally, because I was raised in East of the River as a child. Our destination is where we're going to decide how we're going to get there as a community. Okay? So Philip is going to do something.
I know. Before Philip does something, again, East End or East End of the neither are official names of this side of the board names. Neither one's official. In fact, Councilmember Gray has legislation using the term East End Hospital. That was not the name of the hospital. He was the designation of the location of the hospital from the East End of the city. So, not official either way. And I think this meeting really shed a light on a lot of things in the local council, but basically said the same thing. We need to improve the integrity of the community itself, the neighborhoods itself. And that's about what we call it. It's about us. So we understand what's going on, what we can after tonight. Make sense?
Those heritage
about the history of the neighborhoods. Secondly, we want a really challenging in terms of trying to have viable civic associations in the neighborhoods that don't have them. Councilman Gray, who was ahead of us on that, right? We have about 29 identified neighborhoods in Ward 7. Most of them do have functioning civic associations here. We in Ward 8, we only have 6, even though we have around 16 identified neighborhoods. So we have a lot of work to do. But my closing note, I hope that one of these future meetings, Reverend Rodney, will focus on the issue that Sister Angela brought up. Next year, we're going to have the U.S. Census, which means that this city will be redistricted in 2021. So what is now Ward 7 and Ward 8 are going to look much different. Let's be honest about it. The Amtrak Library right here on Rudolph Road, in the past 40 years, has been in Wards 6, 7, and 8. The library didn't move, but the boundaries changed. You know, and that's why the neighborhood names are so important, because like, 7 and 8, you know, those are political terms, geopolitical terms, just like similar districts, but neighborhoods should be around there forever. So I hope that we, once we start having this East of the River discussion about what is going to happen in redistricting, that we can start discussing this now, so hopefully we can avoid the bitterness that we encountered around 10 years ago when we went through the redistricting. I'm going to be very honest, I think church started promising not to lie much this evening. But the thing about it is, I was in community meetings where there were people in Ward 7 who made it very clear they did not want to be part of Ward 8. They did not want to be part of Ward 8. And there were even people right in this neighborhood of Fairlawn who made it very clear they did not want to be in Ward 8. And of course, late Councilman Marilyn Barry, God rest his soul, wanted to move the boundaries of Ward 8 across the river to include the section of that neighborhood and the baseball stadiums are there. But needless to say, those people weren't even entertaining your idea, even the idea of that. So you know, I just hope that we can start having this type of discussion now and not wait until 2021. You know, so that we can be civil about this. Because let's be honest about it, this very church, Bernard, this church has been in Ward 6, right? Yeah, the Great Garden Ward was also in Ward 6. So anyway, I'm glad everybody you started this discussion. And I also would like, I got to put my pitch in, please join the Anacostia Coordinating Council and your support us in the work that we do. But we are going to be, our goal is to eventually have every neighborhood in Ward 8 have a Bible Study Association. Thank you all very much.
She wanted to say something.
Discussing about this in the East of the River, and I know it's not the
she's saying is that we have intentions on having all these meetings. Is that not right, Reverend Molly? So we're going to ask the board, we can't make a decision for $150,000, but we can have several of these conversations around Ward 7 and 8, and then maybe that the council members would be willing to come forward and do a resolution. I want to say thank you to both the council members on behalf of this talk with CJ.
So let's go with us and we meet this.